Good morning, History 1302. This is your professor once again with another installment of History by Video. So after last week and not being able to meet very much or how we met and so forth, so we've got a few things to discuss and wrap up and move on with. But to recapture and to talk a little bit about what we were up to last, the fact of the matter is that when you say the progressive period, we really can look at it in two ways, one domestically and one internationally. So we'll finish up the domestic discussion. Again, some of that you need to just go ahead and look up and study on your own, because as the semester draws to an end, with things that I just don't have time to lecture on, especially with a truncated schedule and what have you. But we were discussing recall, if I remember correctly, in the last lecture in class, and that recall has to do with the fact that you recall, say, a corrupt, real or imagined, but a corrupt politician from office. The people put together a list, or rather sign a petition. It is put forward on the ballot. The petition is certified, and so you have a vote, direct democracy in a sense, to recall a politician. And the idea would be is that the people did not know they were hiring a man who was corrupt or wicked or whatever, and that because the legislature or the city council or whoever it exactly is so corrupt itself that it would never remove that man from office, and that when the next election came, the people would still not vote for him. It's a little bit of that do-gooder government. It used to be called at times by people who were kind of sneering at them, goo-goo government sort of thing. And the prime example, as I've said again and again, is California. Now, other states have recall, and other states have reform and referendum and initiative, but it's really California that led the way in the progressive era. You still see that to this day in the manner by which it is administered, the state of California. And I believe I was about left off in class discussing the fact that California has a recall provision in it. And the recall provision in it directed toward the governor was exercised in the early 2000s, and if I remember correctly, it was 2003, when a governor named Gray Davis, who had just been reelected in 2002. And by the way, Gray Davis did not really, there was no new revelation about him, but the recall got going, and it really was kind of a mess, I would argue, the more you look back at it historically. By the way, you know, it's not because I was a Gray Davis fan. He was a Democrat, and you know my politics, I guess. But at the same time, I thought what had been done to him was unjust in the sense that there was no doubt about what he was. Nobody hid anything from the fact that he loved money like a hog loves slop. Well, anyways, a recall petition got going, and there were seemingly 1,000 people running for the governorship in this recall scenario. There were varying degrees of cranks and crackpots. You had Hollywood actors and actresses. You had burlesque actresses and so forth. I mean, it was all over the place. You even had Uncle Fester. It was Gary Coleman of Different Strokes fame running as well. But the man who was, because of his Republican ties and because of his movie star status, name recognition, you didn't have to gin anything up with him, was the most likely candidate to really push it, was Arnold Schwarzenegger. And as most of you know, or at least some of you know, Schwarzenegger ended up winning the ballot and becoming governor of California in this recall. But what's interesting, and I think it's worth a little note, I don't know that I'd actually ask you the question on the exam, but it is worth thinking about the fact that the recall petition said the first question it asked when you got into the ballot box is, does or should Governor Gray Davis be recalled as governor of California? Yes or no? If yes, then proceed to question number two. If no, stop. Well, not only did you have that, but the question did arise, and Davis had to ask it, and that was, can I also be on the recall petition? And not only do they recall me, but can my name be on there too? So, in effect, you would have potentially a foolish voter who would say, yes, I believe that Gray Davis needs to be recalled, then go down to the list of names, and we'll look and say, Gray Davis would say, Arnold Schwarzenegger. He's like, oh, I know Gray Davis. I'm going to vote for him because I know him. And Gray Davis, believe it or not, got thousands of votes just on that sort of thing. Didn't come anywhere close to winning, as I recall. Schwarzenegger wins. But that is an example of the recall mechanisms in motion. some other things that you ought to be aware of, and I'll probably touch more on later on after we get to the Nazis in a later lecture toward the end of the semester, is this simple fact. That another aspect of the movement, this progressive movement, it's a really dark, I would argue, sinister aspect of this movement, is the issue of what's called eugenics, and that's spelled E-U-G-E-N-I-C-S. I've touched on it in class, there's a certain amount of, well, the people need to be able to vote out the bad guys. We want good government. But we also want efficiency. And I talked about that with regard to prohibition and what have you. Which, of course, that is what the 18th Amendment, prohibition, is there. But this eugenics movement is a major aspect in the efficiency scientist, and in effect actually also the Darwinist arising and building Darwinist idea of who humanity is. That there are some people who are more fit for positions than others. Perhaps they are more fit for status in society, position in society. Maybe even there are some people to turn the corn over are unfit to have children. And so... And these progressives, don't worry, they appointed for themselves the idea that perhaps there are some who can make these decisions for you. Normally, those people who are starting to preach about and really push the good government, push a new scientific way, push this evolution, this evolutionary idea, particularly the survival of the fittest, are going to appropriate for themselves, especially in this progressive era. Margaret Sanger would be an example here, that we don't need everybody having their finger in the pie. Perhaps we need to exclude people and push them out. Later, it takes on the phrase of life unworthy of life. And you'll see this eugenicist movement get going. And as you read through this, I would expect you to, as you read through, say, Unto a Good Land, I would expect you to look closely for that eugenic stuff. In addition to that, they also have one portrait or one picture particularly that I think is really appropriate and really good to understand for this movement. And you'll see how it works. I mean, things that you may not say today, at least openly, they did. They believe that science is the answer to all these things. And in fact, actually, Charles Darwin's books, one of which is not as well known as others. The Charles Darwin book that I'm thinking of is The Descent of Man. And that one really talks about how the gene pool, so to speak, the evolutionary process had been curtailed and retarded. And I don't mean that in a bad way, but it had been restricted by, they would have meant it in a bad way, but had been restricted by those who were unfit. The evolution of the species was also mixed with the descent of man. So whenever you talk about Darwin, he's often presented in an evolutionary sense, and he's talked about very glowing terms. You go to his house, and it's all pumped up. But then if you get to reading the full body of Darwin thinking of that time period, and Darwin himself plus others, you start to see this idea that if evolution and the idea that you're evolving to a higher standard, that progress is one of the great goals, and science will help lead the way, then those things that would hinder progress, that would hinder evolution, need to be driven off and burned off or cut off, or however you want to express it, that needs to be done. And you'll see facets of this. One of the great one of the great court cases of this era is called Buck versus Bell. And I would ask you to do this for me. And I won't. It's not a paper in the sense that you're going to sit down and write it up and turn it in. I won't have you do that because I'm liable to have to do another couple of videos before this semester is up. But the fact of the matter is, Buck versus Bell is one of the great. You could argue. Racist, classist, or whatever you want. I don't care. It's not really racist, but it is certainly a group of individuals, especially a Supreme Court Justice, Oliver Wendell Holmes Jr., who is going to look down upon others. And you, I would ask you to read a precis or some sort of compendium of that case, Buck versus Bell. But more especially, I'd like you to read some of the more the actual decision, the actual opinions that are handed down in that decision by Wendell Holmes himself. It's not pretty. And we tend to kind of cover that, I say cover it up, but it's not talked about a whole lot. And if it is, it's talked about, well, they were trying to make a better society, so you kind of excuse it. And in a sense, it's the idea, to quote another man of that era, Vladimir Lenin, sometimes you got to break a few eggs to make your omelets. Sometimes you have to crack a few eggs to make your omelet. But Buck versus Bell it was the court case that flew out of it. And again, like I said, I want you to read the basics of the case. I want you to get an idea for it and then figure out what was the court decision and how does that play out? What other states practiced those incarcerations for the feeble-minded and such, as they would have called it? So that eugenicist stuff, that is kind of the ghost in the closet. Well, we don't really have to talk about that a whole lot. So keep that in mind. And I'd like you to, in a sense also, and I've kind of drawn a little bit of a sketch in this lecture, but I want you to kind of try to draw a scientific or a evolutionary understanding. How do you go from being to this? How do you start to say the people who are quote-unquote feeble-minded with a low IQ or whatever should be incarcerated and should be done to and so forth? And where does that go? Where does that go? What are the logical implications of it? And this is where you separate those who just are rote memorization, which has a place in human understanding, to the next level of analytics and the thinking, and to, not necessarily philosophy in a strict sense, where you think deeply and sit on top of a mountain sort of thing. But you can think and say, aha, you studied history here. Aha, you can look back and you can now see the sweep of history working before. You can see where it's going next. For some of you, you'll find this rather enlightening, interesting, perhaps even scary. It's more than just, you know, wave the flag and what have you. So, that's there. The 18th Amendment goes on the books, and it is fair to say, as I've talked about it before, back on, I guess, Tuesday when we did have class to some degree, I talked about prohibition. But talked about prohibition is the fact that it's really the hot button, or one of the hot button issues at the turn of the 20th century, into the early part of the 20th century. What shall we do with the banning of alcohol? Shall we ban alcohol? Is it a good thing? Is it a bad thing? Must it be done in the Constitution and what have you? And they're building momentum. But somewhere around 1910 or so, it seems like the prohibition movement has kind of plateaued. All the states, and there were states, but all the states that had agreed to and had pushed, that had said, you know what, we need to have a banning of all intoxicating spirits. Those groups, that those states that were going for it had done it. There were states like Texas where they came close. The prohibition boys and girls came real close in Texas, but there were too many Texans. Say Giesenschlags and those of Czech names and extractions like a Sinkovich or something of that nature. I mean, again, what I'm saying is it's not the exact family name. What I mean, it's the ethnicity in general. The Germans, the Czechs, the Catholics in general, the Italian immigrants, they did not agree with the Protestant, Baptist, Anglos who would have said in Texas that was really the issue. It wasn't so much the progressive in the scientific sense, though there are a few that would subscribe to that. It was really, what's your background religiously, what's your background ethnically, and that kind of helped settle out who was for what and who was against what, okay? But Texas, they fought it out, and it failed. And there were a lot of Anglos who may have been Protestant, who may not have been Protestant at all, may not have cared anything about religion, who said, nope, I'm not interested in banning alcohol, no thank you. But in about 1910, 1912, it seemed to have plateaued. It seemed that the movement had gone as far as it was going to get. There was going to be no nationwide sweep and the turning off of the spigot of alcohol. And there have been probably 15, 20 states that had done it. So if you think about it that way, so what puts prohibition over the top? And I'll go ahead and do this part of the lecture and just get it over with. The prohibition at home, the progressive at home, what puts them over the top? And the answer is, quite honestly, World War One. It is hard for us to conceive today, because though the war on terror is a big deal, but the way the United States was mobilized for both world wars and the effects of both world wars upon the nation are, I want to say, in a sense argue, are greater than anything that 9/11 or the war on terror has done. Now, we may find out after this election cycle that I may have to change that lecture a little bit, but right now I'll stand by it. But World War One is a transformative event. It really, you go into a war, you think about it, you want to do it, you think it's going to be a great and glorious victory after a laurel leaf victory with a seemingly bloodless, the boys march off and they come back whole and everything's fine. And World War One is a major event. And frankly, folks, I'll tell you this right now, for me as a historian, I think the major event in the 20th century, the most important event, I mean, kind of the pivot of history sort of thing. The pivot of history in World War One, it rather is World War One. That's where everything else flows out from there. I think it's that big of a deal. And in the case of Prohibition, had it not been for the First World War, the Great War, as it's also known, had it not been for the First World War, you probably would not have had National Prohibition written into the Constitution with that, 18th Amendment? So anyways, what is it that does it about the war? Well, first of all, you've got this mass hysteria about the war, and you'll get more of this in the coming lectures about why do we have the First World War, why does the United States get involved, and on from there. So the fact of the matter is that we talk about this, and we go through this. Who are we fighting in World War One? And the answer is the Germans. The Germans, you know that, you should anyways. And to use a little bit of a stereotype that has some truth, You tell me, what is a stereotype of Germans and alcohol? Well, okay, some of you said, well, they like to drink a little bit. They like their beer. And that's a fact. My gosh, I've got family members back of that era and that generations. My grandfather particularly enjoyed a cold drink, as my Baptist teetotaling grandmother said. She would ask from time to time, because she was a true thoroughgoing Baptist. My grandmother was born in 1905. My grandfather was born in 1901. And my grandmother, Baptist, would not drink a drop. And she would ask if they had alcohol, and that was her euphemism. Did they have cold drinks at it? My grandfather enjoyed a cold drink or 10. Well, that's a little bit over the top, but he certainly enjoyed a cold drink or two. The fact of the matter is that when you talk about Germans, there is a certain amount of truth to that stereotype, a certain amount of truth about Czechs who enjoyed cold pivo. But the fact is, too, is that if you think about the brewers of America in this time period, the Anheuser-Busch's, the Spetzel Brewery of Shiner, Texas, the Pearl Brewery, the Lone Star Brewery, and on from there, Miller, which used to be called Mueller. Now, if you think about that for a few minutes, what type of surnames are those? And they're all German for the most part. I'm certain there's others out there too. Pabst, P-A-B-S-T, Schaefer, Shiner. I already said Shiner. You go on the list, it's quite extensive. You just think about the beers that you've seen in the grocery store, and you understand what I mean. And so we're fighting the Germans. And the Germans, they are the evil Hun. They are the rapers of Belgium. They are the great threats to civilization. They are the great threats to humanity. The Germans in the whipping of the American people into the frenzy of World War One are going to be portrayed as these vile creatures out of the primordial ooze who are looking to get American youth drunk and destroy their fighting spirit. If nothing else, the Prohibition guys plus the government at hand too, with Wilson and his type, they are going to be gung-ho to use the war to advance their agenda, particularly the Prohibition boys. They are going to, to borrow a phrase from Rahm Emanuel, who was the chief of staff of President Obama at the start of his term, or his presidency. Rahm Emanuel said this: never let a crisis go to waste. And they didn't. And so they said the crying need of America to protect America from the slaughter of innocents and the killing and the destruction of our youth and our boys, our fighting boys, is that we need to ban alcohol. put that in there. Plus, there was some political missteps of the brewers and the whiskey peddlers and so forth. And put it all together, the war pushes national prohibition over the top. The war pushes national prohibition over the top. In fact, it helps spawn some other things we'll get to later in the class, and we'll discuss at a later time. But the fact of the matter is that, in a sense, if you want to look at how the United States is changing and becoming more powerful and becoming a world power and what it thinks about itself and does, you see that there with prohibition. That is one of the clarion issues of the time period. And even if you think it was silly for them, it was a fool's errand to go chasing after the banning of alcohol. It is fair to say this, that alcohol and related deaths dropped, abuse evidently dropped, things that you would say would be good for society did drop with the banning of alcohol, though of course you have the gangsters and the Al Capones and the scufflaws and what have you that are out there. So anyways, long and the short of it is that alcohol, that issue is a big one to come. Of course, the 19th Amendment deals with the right of women to vote, and I would argue that too is a little bit of an afterwash of the World War I mentality, the radicalism of that. So anyhow, that more or less gets us taken care of for the progressives at home. Again, like I've said to you before in class, just as a friendly reminder here, as you prep for your exam on Thursday of this upcoming week, you need to go ahead and make sure you read some of the passages, those particular acts, those particular movements by Congress, those things that the presidents did, Roosevelt and Wilson especially did, to advance the progressive agenda in print, or rather in law. You should look that up. But and also, by the way, I would also make sure you underscore and understand the importance of Wilson's administration with regard to something called the Federal Reserve. Before we leave progressivism altogether, at least in the domestic sense, I would suggest very heartily that you take a look at at the monetary supply. And the fact is that when you say money and the United States, it is important to remember that probably the second most important person in the United States at the present time, after the president himself, is the Federal Reserve chairwoman, or in this case, chairwoman, normally chairman, but Janet Yellen is her name. But it would stand to reason, anybody who handles or has a handle on the currency and the monetary supply, whether it's interest rates or what have you, how much money is printed by the Fed and put into circulation by the Federal Reserve, that person would be very important. And so whenever a Federal Reserve chairman speaks, the markets particularly listen very intently. So that is worth remembering, because prior to the Federal Reserve in 1913, I'm pretty certain on that. But before the Federal Reserve came around, the fact of the matter is that you had this old sub-treasury plan, and it was really kind of a creaky system that had replaced the Second Bank of the United States that had been destroyed by Jackson 80 years earlier. 75 years earlier, anyways. So I guess what we ought to consider and just keep in mind here is that money matters, and the Federal Reserve is something you ought to pay a little bit of attention to as you make your preparations for this upcoming exam. So, the progressives at home, we've gotten that. Now the progressives at abroad. When I last cut a video, I guess it was, I lectured on Theodore Roosevelt and where he came from and what he was and all that sort of thing. But I think it's fair to remember, too, with old Roosevelt is that he is part of a class of politicians who believe, that the United States is destined for great things. You see that in that speech, The Strenuous Life. It's a very important speech. But you also see this, too, in the writings of a fellow named Alfred Thayer Mahan, M-A-H-A-N, Mahan. Alfred T. Mahan. He's going to write a fairly seminal book. It's called The Influence of Sea Power Upon History. And that book was not read by the mass public. It was read by a large group of people, but still small in the general consensus. But the audience it was written toward were historians, policymakers, government bureaucrats, Navy boys, and military men, presidents, senators alike. And they read this thing. And it's published in about 1885. And what it proposes and what it pushes and says is that any great power, a nation that was truly a great power in history, a nation that wants to take its place amongst the other great powers has to have a navy. And so his basic thrust and thesis was that in order for the United States to become a great power, we must embark upon a naval building exercise. We must build the U.S. Navy into something that is an ocean-going navy. And numerous people drink from this and believe this to be a gospel truth, and that one of which, of course, is Theodore Roosevelt. Theodore Roosevelt is a big believer in the potency and power of a navy. And in fact, the insights of Mahan are good. It's not revolutionary, frankly, but the insights are good, and those insights are true. I mean, if you want to talk about the great historical nations, the great empires, they all had some sort of navies. Most of them had a very good one. Particularly, I'm thinking like the British. That would be the chief and the easiest example. The British Navy ruled the seas, and we're looking to, in effect, either challenge them, or what ended up happening historically is we replace them. We replace the British Navy when they get the British get hauled out or carved out, kind of like you hollow out a building or something. The British were hollowed out by the First and the Second World War, and we replaced them. We replaced them with our Navy. But Roosevelt's a big believer in that, and so one of the things you'll see him push, and Congress agrees to, is the modernization and the enlarging of the U.S. Navy so at least it can go around the world and do this, that, or the other. Roosevelt also, when we talk about the man as president on the foreign policy side, Theodore Roosevelt is going to be awfully fond of an old African proverb that he'd come across, and he'll use it. And he said that Roosevelt put it was is that one in foreign policy particularly should speak softly and carry a big stick. Speak softly and carry a big stick. Now, when you speak softly and ever carry the big stick, you always think, students and myself included, when I was growing up, I always looked at speaking softly, carry big stick. I always went right to the big stick. Ah, the big stick means you need a military presence. Ah, the big stick means you need a navy. And in a sense, that's true. You need to have the ability to intimidate, and it also helps to keep you out of war. Because Roosevelt may have been very bellicose in most of his life, but when he was in office, he was actually quite reserved. Roosevelt was not afraid to go to war. He'd already earned his spurs in combat. We talked about that on a previous video. But Roosevelt was often very proud. Roosevelt was often ready to look for the other way, look for a route around combat. But I think it's fair to say that Roosevelt was always willing to use the diplomatic channels, and that's to speak softly. Whisper into people's ear, talk in a smile, perhaps. And I don't mean that in some sort of cheesy glad hand and slap them on the back sort of thing. But we do need to talk in diplomatic circles. Now, we would tend to think that in order to get mad, you have to get mad and yell. But the really good maneuvers in diplomacy, it seems like, they could make their points be known with a smile on their face and just as deadpan, as regular as it could be. And in the case of Roosevelt and his boys, Roosevelt and his diplomats, they could do that. Roosevelt was a master diplomat. But I think it's fair to say this. Roosevelt understood quite clearly. He said, do not issue an ultimatum or a bluff that you're not willing to back up. You don't do that. You don't draw a line in the sand that you're not willing to back. Or say it a little differently, a corollary to that would be what President Eisenhower said to Jack Kennedy, incoming President Kennedy, evidently, right before Eisenhower left office. He said, don't stick the American flag in the ground unless you stick it in there to win. Don't make a threat or a bluff that you're not willing to back up, because as soon as you are exposed like that, people will not pay any attention to you. And if you do, if you have to fight, fight to win. And that's fairly good That's a fairly good, I guess you could say, set of maxims that a president or diplomatic or military staff should keep in mind as, in a sense, a maxim, if you like. So Roosevelt subscribed to that idea of speaking softly and carrying a big stick, and he's going to show that in several places, one of which is in Panama. One of the things that Roosevelt understood, and this is where this naval idea, this naval position, this naval need comes in, and he also believed it on an economic sense too. He believed that the United States and the world needed a canal through Panama or somewhere in that part of the world. And quite honestly, the Colombian government owned what we call today Panama. The nation of Panama did not exist in 1901 when Roosevelt takes office. But by the time Roosevelt leaves office, it certainly is going to exist. And there was some shenanigans going on there. There was French aspects. And frankly, Roosevelt believed that the crying need, it was a national interest. It wasn't just economic, but it was a national military interest of the United States to build a canal. And Roosevelt sent feelers to the Colombians and said, we would like to build a canal and, say, in a sense, lease or buy the land for this canal zone. The Colombians said, yeah, we can do that, but we're going to extract your eye teeth. Roosevelt was upset about it. He basically said, I'm not going to be shook down this way. He himself said, he said, you could no more trust or nail the Colombians to the wall and get them settled into a place than you could nail currant jelly to a wall. So Roosevelt, I won't say he organized it, but he certainly didn't impede it, and he certainly helped it in a sense, is that when the Colombians decided to rise up against when the Panamanians decided to rise up against Colombia, there happened to be a frigate or two, a destroyer or two, off the coast of Panama to make sure the Colombians couldn't get to and help those Panamanians. The Colombians could not get to Panama to back up the forces and put down the revolt in Panama. And on top of that, the United States is going to recognize Panama within the first day of its declared independence. It was pretty obvious that Roosevelt wanted Panama, and he more particularly wanted that canal. And frankly, Roosevelt couldn't understand why the Colombians were trying to shake him down, because the United States was going to do all the heavy lifting in building this canal. The only thing that the Colombians would have provided was basically a pathway. That's all they do, is provide the land, and we're going to dig it out of that swamp and out of that thicket. So anyways, the Colombians, they lost out and got nothing. We got the canal. Theodore Roosevelt gets the credit for it, and it was really one of the great engineering feats and marvels of the world at the time. Roosevelt thought that was the greatest thing he'd ever done as president. People would ask him, said, Mr. President, Mr. Roosevelt, Colonel Roosevelt, what do you think was your best achievement? And he'd say, pretty much without a doubt, it's like, my best achievement, at least in foreign policy, was that of the canal. And the canal will actually be completed in, I believe, Wilson's term. But everybody knows it was Theodore Roosevelt's canal. And by the way, the money that was offered to the Colombians goes to the Panamanians, and it works out just fine. So now, maybe not from the Colombian perspective, but from the Panamanian and from the American perspective, it certainly worked out okay. But I want to say something I didn't say a minute ago, but I want to say it here. If you want to think about this for a second, pause the video, but here's the question. Why does it matter militarily if you have a canal in Panama for the U.S. military, especially the U.S. Navy? If you're thinking about it, how do you get the Navy from point A to point B? Let's just say the U.S. Navy, and because in 1905 or 1910, 1914, the U.S. Navy is not really a two-ocean Navy at that point in time. It's a large one-ocean Navy. One ocean meaning that you have a Navy, naval ships in the Atlantic, and they have to go to the Pacific if something bubbles up in the Pacific. If they're in the Pacific and they've got to get into the Atlantic, they've got to get there. Some of you know your geography very well, and so tell me, how do you get a a flotilla of naval vessels from, say, San Diego, the great Navy base at San Diego, or even Pearl Harbor, and you get them to, say, New York City. How do you do it without that canal? Your answer was you got to go around the tip of South America through the Straits of Magellan. Then the answer is yes, and of course that is an issue of mileage and time. It's going to take an unbelievable amount of time to go through that and do that. So this was a very big deal. This canal was a very big deal. And oh, by the way, one other thing that you might find interesting, it is through the building of the canal and through the medicine and the issues associated with the building of a canal in a tropical climate, as we start to figure out and get a handle on tropical diseases. I've mentioned before to you that in the 1860s and 70s, you will see tropical diseases get going in the Gulf Coast of the United States. It kills many people. We talked about it in the form of railroading. What do the people of Houston do when they hear the word yellow fever? They shut down the railroad. Well, yellow fever is, of course, mosquito-borne. So is malaria. But they start to figure out how it is transmitted and who's transmitting it in this time period. And what they figure out in order to save the lives of those, at least some of the lives of those workers there, is that in order to work in that part of the world and to dig that canal out and not have your entire crew just killed, because if you go down there and work in it, it potentially is just a death sentence for you. You get sick or just you'll have malaria for the rest of your life. What do you do? Well, folks, you have to, they figure out you got to drain the swamps, so to speak. You've got to have nets. You've got to disperse the water. You can't let standing water hang around. Otherwise, you get mosquitoes. When they figured that out, they were able to knock down the mosquito problems. They were able to knock down the malaria problems, all those problems that were there. And so it has a medical application as well. Not saying that we would never have figured it out, but perhaps it may have taken a little longer. So we've got that. Roosevelt is a believer in American exceptionalism. He does not apologize for America being great. He doesn't cower and say, oh my gosh, we're sorry, let us apologize. He's not that sort of man. He's a very proud American. And his foreign policy reflects it. Some people would say he's aggressive, brash, perhaps imperialist. I would agree. Yeah, all those things are probably true. Roosevelt is going to take what an old piece of paper, an old American position statement called the Monroe Doctrine. And I assume you got some of that when Gloria was teaching the class back in 1301. The Monroe Doctrine is a brief refresher, basically says that there shall be no new settlement by Europeans, colonial settlement in the Western Hemisphere. And what backed it up all those years was the British Navy. They gave us the ability to make that and make that stick. But Roosevelt adds a corollary to it, and it's literally called the Roosevelt Corollary to the Monroe Doctrine. The Monroe Doctrine's still on the books, but it goes like this, that the United States has the right and has the ability to intervene in the affairs of Western Hemispheric nations to protect them from being overrun, being manipulated, being hurt, they doing the hurting in relations with Europeans and so forth. So really what Roosevelt does is, in a sense, he writes a blank check for the United States. Maybe it's not quite blank, but it's certainly a big check for the United States to go down and be, in effect, the policeman and the protector and the big brother of the Western Hemisphere. You'll see this throughout his presidency. You'll see it in Haiti later on. You'll see it the Dominican Republic would be another one, I believe it was. But more particularly, it's almost more the Monroe Doctrine, but it's an issue with Venezuela. Evidently, in about 1905, 1906, the United States came within a whisker of going to war with the Germans in 1905, 1906 over some issues in Venezuela. The Venezuelans had evidently were trying to default on their debts that were owed to the Germans. The Germans were trying to strong arm them, and the Germans were starting to send battle cruisers into the Caribbean. That is a major no-no for the United States. That will stir the United States faster than just about anything. And Roosevelt, through diplomatic channels, privately, delicately, but forcefully, told the Germans, either you back down or you're going to get into a war with the United States. And the Germans at the last minute backed away from it, but Roosevelt starts to take the measure of the Germans. And more particularly, he'll come later on when he is in Britain for the death of the monarch. Anyways, King had died in about 1910, and Roosevelt was there, and he meets the Kaiser of Germany, a fellow named Wilhelm II. And Roosevelt was not very impressed with the man. In fact, he thought he was a very dangerous man for the world. And in fact, Wilhelm was a lot of things, and dangerous was another one. I say that, but I don't want you to think that the Germans of 1914 are the same as the Germans of 1939. They may be militaristic, but they're not the same. So, at least the governments aren't. But the fact of the matter is Roosevelt is going to insert himself into the Central and South America. Roosevelt is also going to send the U.S. Navy on a world mission, kind of say world mission, but a tour around the world. It's basically called the Great White Fleet. Roosevelt is going to, in the Great White Fleet, ran out of coal, evidently somewhere around Singapore, and the U.S. Congress had to appropriate money to bring the ships home. And Roosevelt did it, even though it sent the boys on that tour, even though the Congress has said you couldn't do it. So Roosevelt, what a character, what a character. So the other great thing he does, as far as a brief overview of his foreign policy, is Roosevelt is going to receive the Medal of Honor. Now, he gets that for what he does in the Spanish-American War. He's going to receive the Nobel Prize, the Nobel Peace Prize. In the first decade of the 20th century, it was obvious the Japanese were starting to come up, and they were starting to rise as a nation. They were starting to come into their own as a nation. The Japanese are going to get crossways with the Russians, and by 1907, 1908, it's obvious the Russians are also they're an empire in decline. And so, in a sense, that's a little foreshadowing for the lectures on World War I. But the fact of the matter is that with the decline of the Russians and the rise of the Japanese, and they have that general common area on the back door of Russia and the back door of the Japanese. If you see a map of the Western Pacific, you'll see those two countries, and they get into a war in Manchuria. And then on top of that, the Russians evidently scrapped together everybody that they could find to send a large flotilla to fight it out, to duke it out on the high seas with the Japanese. It took the Russian Navy 9 months to get to the Japanese main islands, and the Japanese Navy puts the Russian fleet to the bottom in the span of about 2 days. It's a disaster. The Russians are humiliated. The Japanese are ascendant. And the world, in a sense, is crying for and wanting somebody to step in and negotiate a settlement between these two proud and proud empires going two different ways. The Roosevelt administration did that. It's called the Portsmouth Conference. He was able to get the Japanese and the Russians to settle the Russo-Japanese War, but at the same time, it's also an indication of what's coming as far as the next few phases of the 20th century, the rise of the Japanese and the collapse of the Russian Empire, the old Romanov Empire. But when you talk about foreign policy and the progressives, it's not just the story of Theodore Roosevelt's presidency. And I don't remember if I said this in the previous lecture, but I'll say it here again if I did. Roosevelt, when he ran in became president in 1901, Roosevelt in 1904 ran for re-election and won in a landslide. But on his electoral night, Roosevelt has the same problem that I have. Theodore Roosevelt, don't call him Teddy, but Theodore Roosevelt, he had the propensity, he had the character flaw of talking too much. And in the sense of Roosevelt, I it's one of my great faults. I yak too much. But the problem with Roosevelt was is that on his electoral night, he had won, and he'd won in a landslide. And he was asked by some reporters, "Mr. Roosevelt, Mr. President, are you going to run for re-election in 1908? And he said, just bam, sort of way, he's like, "No, I'm not going to run for re-election. I will not be a candidate for president." Period. And he didn't retract the statement right away. In fact, didn't retract it at all. But evidently, Miss Edith, was standing right next to him, and she heard that. And if she'd have had a wine glass in her hand, it would have fallen out of her hand. It didn't. Of course, she didn't have one in her hand, but she knew what her husband had just said. Edith was a lot of things for her husband. An advisor, in a sense, was one of them. And she understood quite clearly that her husband had made a major political mistake. Even had Roosevelt just said, "Yes, I'm going to stand down, honey," had Roosevelt just kept his mouth shut, it would have helped him out so much. But in 1908, Roosevelt stands down. He's replaced by William Howard Taft. The William Howard Taft, if you think about him, what's he remembered for? He was a very large man. At times he was 350 pounds, at times 280, but he enjoyed a lot of good meals. William Howard Taft was a very good justice to the Supreme Court. William Howard Taft was not suited to the presidency. That was one of his shortcomings. But William Howard Taft had a resume as long as my arm. You can't see it on the screen, but extend it out.
Yeah, that'll do. That is a good way to do it.
So Roosevelt, Taft had experience left and right. He'd served as the governor in the Philippines. He had served as Secretary of War under Roosevelt. He knew where all the bodies were buried in diplomatic circles and on from there. But Taft is a good man, and he is a very able man. But some men are not, they may be qualified, they're not temperamentally set for the presidency. Taft was that sort of way. Roosevelt, yes to the presidency. Wilson, yes to the presidency. But Taft, not so much. He just temperamentally, he was too cautious at times, too secretive, too nervous, too worrying, too everything, it seems like. And then, of course, his weight fluctuates, and that causes him some troubles and such. But I'll say all that to remind you is that it's not like he died at age 50 of a heart attack. Though William Howard Taft's weight may have been very great, he lives a full life, an exciting life, a large life, figuratively, and I know the pun's there literally. And he gets stuck in the bathtub in the White House. He, however, is going to die at age 73. That, for the time period, even in a sense today, dying at age 73... though that seems to be much closer to me than it was a few years ago now. 73 is a long life. It's a long life. It's beyond what, in a sense, what the blessed life is that's described in the Psalms. But the fact is that when you talk about old Taft and his presidency, it's a one-term hiccup in between there, and there's not a lot to say other than this. When you talk about trust busting, and that's really more of a domestic issue. Taft's presidency and the trust busting was more aggressive than Roosevelt's had been. Roosevelt's called the great trust buster. He makes a big deal about it. Roosevelt is a masterful self-promoter. Never forget that about Roosevelt. That man always had a camera with him or had a movie reel. And it does also remark, too, about Roosevelt is that when he went out to Yosemite or he went horseback riding, there's a photo, and you can look it up if you want to, but there's a photo of Roosevelt on horseback jumping some steeples, in a sense. He's a steeplechase, I guess it would be. He's jumping, and he's doing it while he's president of the United States. But one thing Roosevelt never did was he never let anybody take a picture of him while he was playing tennis, because tennis was not a manly sport. Some would argue today, I guess you'd say buffoons would perhaps argue that today. But the fact of the matter is, tennis in 1905 was considered to be an effete sport. It was the sport of a man whose nose is too far up into the air, sort of thing. Roosevelt cultivated the image of the roughneck, the rough rider, the cowboy, the horse jumper, and cutting down a tree. That's what was good and sweaty. Getting into boxing, and if I didn't tell you this, he was a big boxer. His dad gave him lessons on how to box. Roosevelt boxed in the White House. He did sumo wrestling in the White House. And oh, by the way, Roosevelt lost sight in one of his eyes because he got to boxing with a young man and he never should have been boxing. So anyways, the long and the short of it is that Taft was kind of the anti-Roosevelt, despite the fact that Taft was kind of pushed into the presidency by Mrs. Taft and Theodore Roosevelt, and it was really a mistake for him. He shouldn't have done that. But Roosevelt goes off and kills a whole bunch of animals in Africa, and Roosevelt comes back and becomes more and more disgruntled. Normally, when you talk about presidential politics, every presidential election, they'll tell you this is going to be the most important election in the history of mankind. If you don't vote today, the Republic will fall. That's not normally the case. The Republic has stood good presidents and has stood great presidents and has stood through bad presidents. But occasionally, elections do matter and they really are important. 1800 would be a big year because of the peaceful change of power from one political party to another. Say 1860 with a Lincoln being elected, that was a big one because other men would have let the South go peaceably. Lincoln fought them to a standstill and beat them. 1912 would have been a big election year because 1912, you're really having a referendum on which way do you want the country to go. Do you want it to go down the progressive path that we've talked about, or do you want it to go down another way? I go back to the old pre-Roosevelt era, and you're going to have four people run for president that were really powerful. One won't have a chance at getting, but he still garners almost a million votes, and that's a socialist. And if you've been watching politics or you've been getting politics through your parents or what have you, one of the things that for the longest time Bernie Sanders, and frankly there's no hiding it, Bernie Sanders is an avowed socialist, though he's running right now as a Democrat. And this idea of socialism, the government is here to do so much. Where does the government start and stop at? Where does it start and stop in your life? That's a fundamental question that every voter and every American has to ask and answer in their concept of voting, in their worldview. Where does the government's help start and where does it end? Does it start from the cradle? Does it go to the grave? Is it somewhere in between? To what degree and extent when it helps? All those things are there. The socialists would say we must do all we can. And we must restrict the money classes, we must restrict the big businesses, we must protect the people to give free education, free this, free that, what have you. And so the man who is really going to push this, and they were also pacifists too, is a fellow named Eugene V. Debs, D-E-B-S, Eugene Debs. Debs will ultimately spend, by the way, World War I in jail because he was opposed to the war. I didn't misspeak. Debs was arrested for opposing World War I, and Woodrow Wilson, Archangel Woody, will put him in jail. That's a socialist, and he's not going to win, but he gets a lot of votes. The Republican Party, which is the majority party in 1912, is split. Theodore Roosevelt said, I'm not going to run in 1908, but he didn't say, I'll never run again. He just said, I'm not going to run. I'm not going to ask for another term as president. People took that to mean different things. Roosevelt came back around in 1912 and said Taft didn't do what he should have done or didn't do what I would have done. And so therefore Taft is too fat, and that's the way Roosevelt would at times refer to him. He was Roosevelt would make fun of Taft. And they were friends. They had been friends. But they made fun of Taft for being overweight and et cetera, and so on. And Roosevelt runs on what's called the Progressive Party. Roosevelt's running mate is a fellow named Hiram, H-I-R-A-M, Hiram Johnson. Hiram Johnson is a governor from California, and he's a progressive. I've talked about that as well, which, by the way, reminds me of one other thing. Another big state for progressive ideas and movements and such is Wisconsin, Robert La Follette in Wisconsin. But Hiram Johnson and Roosevelt make a team, a ticket, and Roosevelt's party is called the Bull Moose Party, in addition to the progressive. The nickname was the Bull Moose. The Republican candidate is William Howard Taft. Taft had beaten Roosevelt back, had turned back Roosevelt's attempts to take the mantle of leadership from the Republican Party back from Taft. Taft is the wounded and the party leader for the Republican Party. Taft is, well, the Republicans are split, and so that means the election of 1912 will go to a new man, and that man's name is Woodrow Wilson. Woodrow Wilson. One of the more important characters you'll come across probably depends on your politics and views of things. Depends on whether you think he's a great man or a devil. Actually, right now, Woodrow Wilson is a bit of a controversial figure in 2015-16 America. Because on the one hand, Woodrow Wilson, and we'll talk more about him personally when we get into the classroom, Woodrow Wilson on the one hand is a big proponent of progressive ideas. But on the other hand, Woodrow Wilson is about as stark of a racist as you're going to get. It was Wilson who really pushed the idea of segregating the federal bureaucracy. So, Woodrow Wilson carries the banner for the Democratic Party. He is a professor, he is a college president, and he's governor of New Jersey, though he's actually was born in the South down around Atlanta, Georgia. The fact of the matter is that old Wilson is going to be the man who carries the United States forward from 1912 to 1918. And if you look, if you would, and I'm not going to lecture on this because I want to save that for the coming World War I. One of the things you need to do is that when you read about Wilson and Unto a Good Land, look at what he does in foreign policy. Roosevelt has his concept of things. Wilson has his own concept of how to deal with the Central and South Americans. He handles them differently. What's going on in Mexico in the 1910s? I invite you to really look that up. Mexico is not a stable nation. And on from there. There's a whole lot that is going on in Mexico that affects Wilson's foreign policy and affects America in the mid-1910s. So those are some places to go. So I'm going to call a stop right here. I'm going to check a few things, and we'll see you in class soon. So we'll see you in class on Tuesday, hopefully. Thank you.